the dick.
Welcome into Runner's Recap with Coach Barnes. Joining me after a week where we didn't get to meet with you, but you're a little bit busy. You had the WAC tournament to think of. So, Coach, obviously not the ending or therefore the start that you guys wanted to have in that tournament, but what can you say about what you saw from your guys on the court? It was a tough beginning, put you guys down in the hole there, UTRGV did, but then you guys tried to make that comeback and it just didn't come around in that third and fourth quarter. So perspective from you.
Well, they came out and they really were the aggressor. They made some shots and we didn't early, and they built a really big lead, and they're not the type of team that you want to get too far behind just because their style of play. They really try to attack the basket and get to the free throw line. I thought we made a run. I thought our guys showed a lot of determination to get back. I thought we made some good plays, but not enough plays to get us back in the game where we're there. We were proud of our guys and the effort that they played with. But early on, we just dug too big of a hole to get out of it.
And I just wanted to ask you, from throughout the season, you saw a lot of different situations, game situations. Was that the first time that you feel that was just too big of a lead against a team like that, that could do something offensively like that?
I just thought it was the wrong place. You know, sometimes, the preseason or the non-conference and in the conference, and then you get that was a game that's kind of a do-or-die game. And knew both teams would be really focused and trying to play their best basketball. And they've been really playing well. And then when you get a team down like we were early in the game, it's just a tough situation to come back. It's a little bit different if it's mid-season or something like that. I was concerned because the way we got down, and I knew the way that they play, that we had an uphill battle. But at halftime, I thought we could come back. Our guys were positive at the half. Sometimes when you have leads and you fight back, you know, you get in the dressing room and you're like, we're probably not going to make it back. I thought our guys had the right frame of mind. And we went out and, again, we made a run to come back, but it was just not enough. But I was concerned right from the beginning. I think on the third possession they had, maybe – fourth possession, I called timeout because I was concerned how easy they scored, and I was concerned that we missed some easy shots. So I was trying to get our guys, you know, kind of lock in and focus, but also calm down. We were really excited about the opportunity. I think our guys went over there to win, and I just thought right from the beginning, our hearts and minds, I would say, was on winning, but then the focus that you need to be locked in to each and every play. It took us a while to get settled, and that was a tough thing as a coach, because I thought we had prepared for that as far as if we get behind, to know how to handle those situations. But again, being in a tournament, you know, things happen, and that's how you get upsets. That's how people that play great, you know, and I even talked to their coach afterwards. He told me he thought that was the second best game they had played all season, but that's what you want to do. And he thought their best game was against Houston, and they lost a close game with them and thought this was the next best game. But I didn't think we ever got in a chance to figure out whether it was we play our best, because once we dug ourselves a hole, we were trying to come back all night, and again, we were unsuccessful.
And you had mentioned this ahead of the tournament, but one of the things with a young team is getting in those situations and not having that experience to almost know what to do out on the court and kind of letting it get the game, or I guess that lead, get ahead of you. So with that, do you feel that was maybe the difference? The factor that really changed it was the youth on the court compared to what the Vaqueros had out there?
I think that's some of it, not all of it. Right. I think some of it. I think, you know, if you go back and look at it, their first four shots, their seniors took those shots, and they made three of the four, and we didn't do that. And because, again, we were not playing with a lot of seniors. So I think early on, their coach made a decision, we're gonna go with the guys that have the experience that's been in this situation. And we tried to do that. Again, I thought we had some good looks, and we didn't make them. And then it gets into substitution. And as we substitute, we get younger. I mean, we bring freshmen off the bench, and that's not a good I guess, good, I wouldn't say strategy, but when you're on in those kind of situations, if you're coming off the bench with juniors and seniors, it's a little bit different. And we were coming off the bench with freshmen and sophomore. So really, their league grew during that time because we were having guys with the new experience out there. But I don't want to take anything from them either. I mean, I thought they played really well. I thought they executed what they needed to do. But again, you know, our youth's shown. And again, as you move forward, a lot of time at the mid-major levels, you know, most of the time the coaches would say, you know, you want to be old. You don't want to be young. Yeah. And this year we were young in a lot of key places.
And Coach, I know this is a little bit of a tough issue for you guys, but I do want to ask, with that news that came out before the WAC tournament that Damian Durham would be off the team, do you feel that maybe, I know you've spoken of this team is an emotional team, and I'm sure that news kind of hit hard for some of the players. Yeah. Did that at all have any effect in some of the confidence from the younger guys knowing that they were without him?
I mean, whenever something like that happened, you know, you never plan for that. You always... And we teach brotherhood, we teach family, so it would be like anything else, that someone that's been working with you, that you're really close with, that you've built a close relationship with, and now you're preparing to go into war, and you're going to battle, and they're not there. I think it affected our team, our level of confidence, because he was the one guy that's been to the tournament, that has performed really well,
exactly,
that was all conference. And now you don't have, you know, him on the team. And it's a difficult situation as the head coach to make a decision like that. But, you know, as I told the team, you know, Damian had some opportunities to correct things that he was doing wrong. And it comes to a place that, am I looking out for just one individual? Am I looking out for our program? Am I looking out for the team? Who no one is bigger than our team, not even me. And that's what we teach. No one is any bigger in the family than anyone else. And, you know, Damian's situation, it wasn't anything that he did that was so against NCAA violation. It was just the standard and what we believe in our program. And when you start to not respect that, you know, that this is a privilege to be a part of our team. It's obviously a privilege to be a part of our family. So many special people make up our family. And when that seems to be not your focus for the better of the family, again, it's time to go. Mm-hmm. And as I told our players, you know, I love Damian. I have three boys. It comes a time when they're grown that they need to get out on their own. They need to spread their wings. It's just unfortunate that it happened to our team when it did. But we'll grow from it. I think we'll teach other guys lessons. Our program will continue to stand on what we stand on. That's how we build it. And again, we hope the best for Damian and his future. And again, we're rooting for him. But just it comes a time when it gets past the team into our program. And when it starts to affect our program, then I, as the leader, have to step in and correct it.
And if anyone who knows anything about you and your values, that was not an easy decision. That was not a decision made without love by any means. So.
Yes.
I'm sure that was a tough moment, tough for the guys too that have been playing with Damian. But moving ahead, so you guys fall in the opener of the WAC tournament, but you get the news and you get the invite to play in the CIT. So one more chance. And I know for those seniors left on the team, I'm sure that they're excited. Can you talk about how excited you are for them to get this one last opportunity to prove themselves in this final tournament?
Well, I am. I mean, when you look at our seniors that are left, you got Ricky Holder that hasn't played in a postseason because of last season, now this season. So we're obviously excited for him. James Suber has been here, and he's experienced going as postseason play. So, you know, he was a part of a team that went to the postseason, and then my son, Bray. But excited also for our young guys, having that experience for the first time. And I think we all are excited about coaching and playing because, obviously, the experience in Vegas, you don't want to leave like that. You don't want your season to end like that. We know it's all going to end at some point. But you want to end with playing well. You want to end on a good note. And that wasn't a good note for us. We didn't give ourselves a chance to win. And we always talk about giving ourselves the opportunity to win. And we didn't do that. And we're hoping Thursday night as we go and take on Fullerton that we put ourselves in that position. But not only that, we need a win for our team and for our program. And just even for us going forward, that we don't have that kind of taste we had in our mouth driving back from Vegas.
Yeah, and that's where I'd love to get your perspective with the seniors. I mean, this is their moment. This is really it for them to, you know, you don't always get that second chance. So right. Like you said, a bad taste in your mouth at the WAC tournament before these seniors, and you could see the disappointment. One in particular, Ricky Holden, I saw him on the bench, and his emotion was on full display. So for them, do you think that this is going to be a good opportunity for them to say, hey, this is how we leave the program, we leave it the right way, and a good learning opportunity for them to show the young guys?
Well, I think so. I think even as we talked and we discussed this afterward about our team, just telling them about how you don't always get opportunities and second opportunities. And I know Rick and James both really went out on the court ready to go, and it was unfortunate what happened. So I think right now it's kind of redemption. It's more of a, we get another opportunity. And I think just the enthusiasm from coaches and players at a high point right now.
Absolutely. And so we were talking a little bit earlier that the opponent is someone that you guys are going to get familiar with after this next season will be your last in the WAC, and you'll be moving to the Big West. So CSU Fullerton, they just played in the Big West Championship, but they fell. So two hungry opponents coming into this opener for the CIT. What are you looking at when you're looking at Fullerton, and who has the edge? Obviously, they're playing on home court, but who's going to have the edge in this one, do you think?
Well, I think they have the edge. Obviously, when you're at home, you know, all the statistics or analytics say that the home team is most of the time favored, and it's been proven. Also, I thought they played really well to get to the finals. I think it's, again, two teams that are going to be excited about playing postseason play. I think they're probably upset because they're not playing the NCAA tournament because they lost in the championship game. But they were playing well. And I think we want to prove ourselves that we're a better team than what we displayed, you know, in our tournament. So I'm excited. Two kind of equally, I would say, teams. They're not some team that, you know, we haven't played that level of competition, but they are good. And we're going to have to play well to win. And that's good for us. It's good for us to go to this postseason because hopefully next year, you know, we're in the NCAA tournament, and whoever we play then will be a good team. Just want to play them on their home court, but I really looking forward to seeing how our guys react.
Yeah, and in this moment, Coach, for you, what's the bigger takeaway? Is it just to, as you said, give experience and opportunity to the young guys so they see more of a postseason play? Or is it hoping that you guys just in general for this squad this year, they leave on the right note? Which one do you think plays more of a role for you?
Well, I think, you know, just leaving on a good note is probably because we always talk about legacies and last year's team and what we're trying to do. And if we can go and win a game, that would be great. I think our young guys have already proven to me, because I was wondering after we got the call to play in postseason, how our team would react. Mm-hmm. So from that standpoint, we've already accomplished what I wanted to accomplish in that, because there are some teams that would be, guys would not really want to play, like, oh man, we didn't go to NCAA tournament, NIT, you know, I don't really want to go play. This team is excited about playing, so I mean, they've passed that test. Now hopefully we can go out and get a win for our seniors, so we can leave on a good note, good taste in our mouth that we played our better basketball toward the end of their career.
All right, so you transitioned well into my first question in that burning up hot seat, the breakdown with Barnes. You, as you said, good experience for your players, good experience for you. We're episode 22. You can handle this. This
I
is
got
all,
it.
All
ready.
Good stuff. But yeah, so that was my first question to you is obviously all along the whole season, everyone wants to be playing in the NCAA tournament. Yeah. When you don't get that opportunity, and also in your conference tournament when the opportunity falls so short so soon.
Yeah.
How do you, what's the right mindset then, I guess, for these other tournaments that you get into? What do you hope that your players will be thinking heading into a game and not worried about the fact that, oh, we didn't get there, but make the most of the opportunity we have in front of us?
Well, I think the first thing, and my approach is always to them, we all want to set our goals high. We always want to think the best is always going to happen, and sometimes that does happen for you, and you're thankful for that, and sometimes it doesn't. And how do you handle adversity? How do you handle losing if we were in the championship game and not going? How do you handle losing in the first round and coming back and preparing? And again, I think it's all, as I try to tell them, it's all a part of life. It's all training grounds where as you continue to live, you're going to have some opportunities you're going to think great, and you're not going to get that call, or you're not going to get that raise, or you're not going to get that promotion. What happens to you? Do you take it and say, okay, we'll come back and we'll be better next time, or we'll come back and we'll change some things? So I think for us, and I told them, it's important, especially with the younger. If our team was full of seniors across the board, then maybe it's a little bit more difficult to try to get everybody going. But this is a beginning for us, and I think you said that in the beginning, it's really the beginning for this younger group of guys to kind of put a stamp on their legacy, you know. And we can hopefully advance in this tournament and make the tournament next year, the NCAA tournament, and it could just continues to give you momentum. So we've got to look at it. It has happened. Now it's our response. And I'm always, you know, one of those that believe things are going to happen to you. It's how you respond to kind of determine whether you're successful in life or not. And we want to be successful. So we've got to have the right mindset going there that we get another opportunity. And with this opportunity, we want to take advantage of it.
All right. One thing about this team in particular for this year has been, and you've talked about it all year long, is it's an emotional team. They're driven by their emotions. They feel for their brothers on the court. And they the highs and lows of the seasons, obviously, we kind of seen that take effect. So what have you learned from this group and those emotions to use that in a positive way? Right. And then, as you said, it's all about response with Thursday's first game in the CIT. So, yeah, as a coach, what have you learned from this emotional group, and maybe thinking, hey, you know what, it's not so bad to have the emotions when it goes the right way?
Well, it's not. The great thing about it is you know their feelings.
Right.
And I think as a coach, to know they're high or they're low, or this is good and this bad, you start to see and understand a little bit more. They are a very emotional group. And I think that's one of the reasons why we've had several losses in a row lately, because when they're up, they're up. And they don't sink, you know, to they're really a down team or they're out team. It's just the same kind of emotion that it takes. They'll work really hard to get to that level. And, I've learned, obviously being the first time, you watch, you try to make the right decisions. You try to learn from the experiences. And they've taught me a lot of just understand how to manage a team that's that emotional. I'm not an emotional kind of guy. So it's a learning process for me of how to deal with a team that's like that. I've had players like that, but a whole team that's like that. It's taught me a lot. And I'll be better prepared. Unfortunately, I haven't had it before. Mm-hmm. I'll be better prepared for the next team that, you know, this kind of emotion, carry that kind of emotions with them, because as they have, and I always do, I've made some great decisions this year. And then I've also, you know, made some choices that didn't benefit our team. So, but I've learned from it, and we'll be better the next time I have a bunch of guys like this.
All right, and with this team, Coach, season's not over, but when you get in that mode of reflecting on these are going to be, you know, your last moments with this group in particular. Again, not so many will be leaving, all of a lot of returning players, but what's the one thing that stands out that just really ultimately makes you the most proud about this group?
That spirit that we just talked about. Mm-hmm. You know, they really have a connection with each other, and it's also been a growing kind of watching so many mature. Not only just guys that were freshmen and sophomores, but seeing James Suber come from a guy that didn't score and didn't play a lot to being one of the better rebounders in the country, to seeing Ricky not come here starting as a point guard to develop into being a point guard, to even seeing my own son, you know, toward the end of the year start to speak up and show the kind of leadership that his dad's been seeing in him, but just for him to exceed it and see it manifest. So it's been a growing process for so many of our players, and probably the most that I've ever been. That's why I say I think even with the emotion, but the spirit of this team is something that I'll know, you know, I always remember for this.
Yeah, and no matter what happens, wins or losses, if you can get your guys to develop and grow, that's part of it.
That's
a huge part.
Yeah.
All right, so we were just in Vegas for this tournament. When you're in Vegas, it's gambling, it's some betting, and especially March Madness. So to bring our attention back to that NCAA tournament, hot takes, Coach.
Okay.
Who you got? if you had to place a bet on a team with all of, you know, there's obviously one team in mind for many people that think that's going to win it all. But
well, it's not my team.
Okay, so who you got? You ought to say.
I'll take the field.
Hey, that's something I learned in Vegas. It's my first time ever being there where I was legally allowed to be near tables and stuff.
I'm not legally allowed to make any decisions, so that's why I said I'll take the field.
Gotcha. I tried, guys.
I don't want to get called. And I heard you on your show, so I'll take the field.
All right. We know some important people might be watching, and we're not going to put Coach in that position.
Yeah. We'll take the field.
Yeah, I know.
We're going to win.
I'm just going to tell you all, I don't do well with predictions, and I love it if we see upsets and things like this, but go Devils.
Go Devils.
Gotcha. That's my alma mater. I have to go with them, right? Ride or die.
You do.
All right, Coach, as always, since we've been doing the last few shows, I let you have the last question.
Yep.
So I really put you in the hot seat. I apologize for that.
You did. So my question to you today, being at the first WAC tournament.
Okay. Yep.
What did you learn, or what did that experience, what was that experience like for you?
So this will kind of bleed into the season, something that we've talked about before, just with the conference in general. There's a lot of excitement that I think people don't give credit when you have those Power Five conferences that people always talk about and people don't show love to all of the other conferences. For the sport of basketball, from my experience, not only with the season and the tournament that you got to see, there is a lot of pride in these teams that are playing. And what I love is that in any given night, anybody has a shot. It doesn't matter. There's a lot of talent. There's, you know, a lot of picks, of course. New Mexico State made their case this year. But any game, everyone's, you know, usually they got a shot. Whether you have a shot right away or you have a shot and a comeback later.
Right.
And I think that that made it fun just to cover the conference. I'm sure it didn't make it as fun for you throughout the season. But it's cool knowing that any given night, any given game, that there's enough talent in this conference
right.
for basketball. And that goes for both men's and women. So I had fun there.
That's
great. It was a good energy, good vibes at the WAC tournament.
It was. Conference has grown, the competition, the coaches that are in our league, the commitment from the administration and from the conference offices obviously gotten better, and it continues to get better. I would expect next seasons to be no difference when you're looking at the teams that are returning some of their best players and the recruits that have already been signed. It's going to be another exciting year, and we look forward to it, but we're not done yet.
No,
we still
not.
Have games to play this year.
Yes, you're not done yet, and we will just leave on the note that next year is a statement year for the CSUB Roadrunners because it will be their final year in this conference. So we'll be looking ahead to that, but we will be staying in tune with you guys for the CIT and wish you guys luck on the road on Thursday.
Thank you.
All right, Coach, thanks for joining us, and thank you for joining us for Runners Recap. We'll see you next week.